Hi, welcome to the MeeGo Freeday here in the sea base in Berlin. Today we have two topics. The first one is a talk about the MeeGo touch, name, the MeeGo input methods, that's a right term. and the project is called Maliit. And so these two guys will tell you something about it, and we will have time to ask questions and so
okay,
have fun.
My name is Michael. I'm working for Organismus, software developer, and for most time of the last year and also this year I've been working for Nokia on these input methods for MeeGo and also Harmagen. This is Harmagen. This is about this nice device announcement earlier this week. My colleague John Nordby, also working for Organismus, also a software developer. He always annoys me to hell with his documentation bias. Then over there we have Janana, same company. He was very, very helpful for our performance tasks. Because at some point we had performance problems, of course, like in every project. So yeah, let's start to talk about Maliit. Maliit is the project name, as already mentioned. And what are input methods? Maybe just start with a small definition. So input methods are a component that allows any data to be input, and in particular characters and symbols not found on input devices. So this is a definition shortened and taken from Wikipedia. This usually means input methods in the traditional sense is for additional stuff that you can't find on your hardware keyboard, or that would be difficult to input in any other way. Then these input methods are supposed to help you with that, so you don't have to enter key codes or whatever. Then, since recent years, there's also the other domain where you have devices without a hardware keyboard, just with a touch screen, and then this touch screen becomes the input device, and then we talk about virtual keyboards. And this extends the original definition of input methods, actually. Where does it come from? The people who, of course, have the most need for input methods are those from the Asian market. With Latin languages, Western languages, you don't have these problems usually. You just need a normal QWERTY keyboard and then you are good to go and you will encounter no problems. But if you are from Asia, then these languages are a bit more complex and characters or words are usually composed. So you have to imagine, in order to create one Chinese symbol, you probably need to type three characters on the keyboard first in a specified order, and then you get the composed character. Or you have a stroke-based input method, where certain strokes then form these Chinese characters. Or you have handwriting, or that is an input method. And you can probably imagine that this requires different interaction modes that you usually don't find on a normal virtual keyboard. But Maliit also covers these cases. So it's actually, with the right input method engines, we can also support that. The other topic, of course, accessibility is something where we currently have no support for, no direct support. But this would be a matter then of, if someone wanted to start on that, you would be happy to help out with it. I can explain later then maybe how that would work. So what is Maliit? Maliit is a framework for text input methods. A framework in the sense it makes it easier to write these kind of systems on platforms such as MeeGo, Harmagen, but recently we turned our scope to other Linux distros as well. So yeah. That's what we had a funny meal last week, or what was it, 2 weeks ago, where we declared our independence from MeeGo and Harmagen. Basically it meant we moved to our own website, maliit.org, we moved our code to our own repositories. It noise, and we said to ourselves, no more deadlines. We want to do what we feel is right. We want to make it possible for others to actually contribute to our project. And the funny part is, and then maybe we are Harmony, people said, yeah, but you are a Harmony project. How are others supposed to contribute? Even though our code was out there in the open, it was still difficult, of course, for them to participate, or because it wasn't easy to build. It's like a component's missing. Then we moved to MeeGo, and that's the same. Well, yeah, but you are a MeeGo project. Why should we have you on GNOME or OpenSUSE? You are a MeeGo project. We don't want you. Or they couldn't imagine, simply because you have this prefix, Harmony or MeeGo, that this project would also work for their desktop. And we're trying to solve that with our Declaration of Independence. Yeah, so this is how it can look like with some input methods on different UI devices. What we see here is a virtual keyboard in different forms, sizes, on the Ava handset that was the Intel phone shown last year. We have it on this IdeaPad that on the right side that was handed out on the first MeeGo conference in Dublin last year. In the center, we see the virtual keyboard running on Maliit and Plasma, so that's KDE. And at the bottom, we see the keyboard, maybe not so well, we see it running in GNOME Shell, on GNOME 3. And we have it actually there on the VTab. So if you want to see it, you can turn it around. So let's have some live demo, of course. So this is my development environment. Yeah, maybe some of you know that already. This is the MeeGo Touch Widgets Gallery, and MeeGo Touch is this toolkit built on top for Harmony. So you know, we can see here the keyboard. Yeah, type some stuff. I can switch languages, for example. I can access additional characters here, whatever. So it's a basic functionality you have. But you can also show it in a header way.
So yeah, you might recognize this device. This launched this week. And this shows some of the basic interactions. So swipe to a new keyboard. And here you have, for instance, the swipe keyboard, which has swipe as a primary interaction for also entering the text input. So you basically compose a word by moving over all the characters you want it to be composed of. And it's a bit hard to see, but you can see this. You can select them if it's DAO. Then you can select back to the normal keyboard, which we provide. And back to swipe again. So that is was a demo done on the N9.
What are the features? As you've seen, we can support different UI toolkits. This is, I would see it as one of the main features of our architecture. So we are not bound to only Qt applications. We can, our stuff, our framework also runs fine with this GTK applications. And the next thing is these plugins that you, these input method plugins that you write for Mali, they don't have to be in the same toolkit as the application. So we have a nice toolkit area so that both parts can move independently and you can use whatever you want. So whenever we are able to support a new toolkit or a new platform, we can move all the existing plugins, input method plugins, to that new platform as well. So I see that as one of the main advantages. As we've seen in the video, where you could switch between swipe and the normal keyboard, it is pluggable. But not only the UI parts, also the engines. You can have different word predictions, error word correction. You can have engines for TJK support for India. It comes in a client server architecture, and maybe that sounds a bit old school, but let me explain briefly why we have a client server architecture. First, it helps with startup time of applications. Applications cloud, and they don't have to load all the framework all the time. They're just connected to the server. This, you can imagine, even if the startup time of your application is 1 second, and the one of the framework is maybe half, it's also 1 second, then you cut it in half by simply having, by simply separating it. You only need to load the server once, and everything connects to it. Stability is also one of these features. It's easier to just, when the plugin crashes, and if you have plugins from third-party developers, this will always happen if the framework crashes. It's kind of easier to just restart this input method server than taking everything else with you. It's nice that the application stays alive, even though you have bugs in these input method plugins. And then it just comes back up and you can continue. So, less is the impact of crashes. When you go to the repositories, again, already shown, it comes with reference plugins. So it's not just a framework, but we also provide a virtual keyboard. Actually two, one that is very feature-rich and one that is more like a playground for us to learn more about QML and new technologies. And these two plugins come for free already. And there are even others already, other open source plugins using this. So for the adventurers, you can try to compile them and get them to run. It's not so easy right now. The plugin APIs that we offer is classical C++. We realize that most people don't like that too much. So we also offer actually a very easy to access QML interface. It's, as I said, work in progress. That means we're still not sure about the API that we extended. We might remove stuff. It doesn't come with the full functionality that the original API has. And we also have something very nice because of the Nokia background in MIMO, where Python was very popular. We are working on Python support, so you don't need any C++ or at all. The idea is that you can do everything in Python and. It was demonstrated at the MeeGo conference in San Francisco how easily you can do QML from Python. So you don't lose anything actually with PySide. That's quite nice. PySide is also in the Harmattan SDK officially. So there you go. Now we have the big picture of the architecture. Everything that's in the colored orange on the left side.
One slide back, please. You mentioned in QML there was some things missing. Did I get that correctly?
Missing from, yeah.
Is there some technical limitation that you're facing, or is it just in general that it's not ready yet? Because you said it didn't have the same functionality as the same possibilities as in C++.
That's only from all that we can offer so far. We cannot map, or what we realized, it's not so easy to map the interfaces that we have for C++ one-to-one to QML. There we have to provide a root context, and we have to map certain things to properties, and we have to think, oh, we need a slot here, we might need an additional signals here, or whatever. So this communication is slightly different, and this slows us down.
Okay. Yeah, so we basically, this is a purely practical problem that we haven't put a lot of effort into it, and also it just takes some time, but it's not super hard work, and it's something that you could, if anyone's interested in, can really contribute to.
Okay, sorry. So what we have on the left here again is what lives in the client process. So the application loads up a input context. This is application-wide, plugin interface, and you can basically use different input methods. It's controls for an environment variable, usually. On Harmattan, it always loads up our Maliit framework. And then, when once you come to an input widget that can accept input methods, it communicates with this input context and gets input method events from it, which then are basically, in the end, just pre-added and commit strings, so meaning it carries a word or a character, which is then inserted into this text entry. And with pre-added, you have some control that you can still modify it on the input method side before you commit it to the text entry. So, yeah. This is living in the client. This is living on the client side, this application, and everything that's colored in this blue grayish tone is the framework side, the server process. So you can see that the framework frame extends to the input context, meaning we have to provide it, of course, and we have to provide such an input context for every platform that we want to offer our framework. But that's it. The rest can stay the same, we only have to provide different input contexts. So that makes it very easy for us to actually get started on new platforms. But then getting nice application integration that actually works the way we intended it. This is quite hard. We have to work together with the toolkits. We have to beg them to actually accept our patches, our extensions, and lots of discussions about the usefulness of certain extensions as well. We of course have a strong background in handsets, so we are of course a bit biased, I think. So let's go back to the right side. There we have the input method server, which uses input context connection to talk to this input context. And the arrow that you see in the center there, we currently use a dbus connection. So this is technically this UI toolkit barrier that I talked about earlier. This allows us to have the plugins written in one language or using one toolkit, and the applications using a completely different one. Through this dbus barrier in the middle, we achieve that. This input method server then is responsible for selecting the switching between this active between these input method plugins, showing them on the screen in an overlay mode, as you've seen earlier. Maybe the keyboard comes up, and you can see it on the Vita as well. This screen 3, the application stays active. It's not that you come up as a full screen keyboard. You have to type the text there, and then you go back and then insert it. While you type the text, while you use the keyboard, you can still use the application, pan up and down. You can click buttons there, whatever. This is also provided by the input method server, this feature. Input method plugins then have to hook up with input method engines or with feedback engines themselves. This is, you could argue, why don't you move all the stuff into the framework? But it's simple. The more stuff you do in the framework, the more we restrict the flexibility of plugins. And it's one of those fundamental decisions that we leave the UI to the end, and the engine, the input method engine handling to the plugin, which allows us to have such different plugins working with the same framework as we've seen before, swipe and the reference keyboard, and we have support for handwriting recognition. We can all use the same interfaces, the same framework, because we give them the flexibility to basically do whatever they want.
Yeah. I'll show you a bit on our wiki. Our wiki is our, basically, not just a wiki, but also our webpage. Actually, I have these open somewhere. You put the wiki. This is not what I want to put. Okay. So, our start page. You can access that from maliit.org. Currently, it's hosted on the MeeGo wiki. As Michel said, we are moving to become an independent project. And this is kind of work in progress, so we don't have our own host for this yet. On our overview page, you will find our goals. And at least I think it's very, very important for an open source project, or any project, to have solid goals to work that you actually work against. And Maliit aims to be the implemented framework for MeeGo and other new Linux-based embedded to mobile platforms. And here are some points we think are fundamental to be able to do this. And it's providing a solid implemented framework, which Michel has explained now, and a core set of implemented. These are the reference plugins we have. And but perhaps more importantly is to empower third-party developers. This is why it's important that you can write your plugins, which is perhaps the most important thing for third-party developers. To write their plugins in Python, in QML, or in C++ if they prefer. Just because people prefer different types of different languages, basically. And also, another important thing is to write an application that integrates easily. So we have a kind of work in progress, really easy interface to really integrate with the virtual keyboard. You can do stuff like overriding the action button, which is like typically like enter, but it can also be OK if that makes sense for the application, or it can be send if it's a messaging application, for instance. And also important for an open source project, a healthy open source project, is to build a diverse community of contributors. I mean, we have a pretty big team, but we still need more people with different backgrounds, different skills, and perhaps different interests as well. As long as it's within our goals. That's very, very good. And if you want to get in touch with us, now you can talk to us directly, of course, but we also have these communication channels. Mailing list, developers like this. But you can also find us almost 24/7 on MeeGo Input Methods, Freenode, IRC, and Bug Tracker if there are issues, of course. There will be, hopefully, eventually, some our own bug tracker somewhere. And then we will keep MeeGo for MeeGo-specific bugs. So also, you have this navigation page. Interesting to show here right now is the documentation. It's a bit rough by my standards. I think documentation is really important. We have some stuff for plugin development, which is, as I said, the most important thing. We'll talk about more about that later. Installing. If you want to install Maliit on different platforms, you have a pretty decent list here now. MeeGo comes installed by default, so it's not very interesting, except for Netbook. There you find the instructions there. Ubuntu, Debian. Debian we don't have proper packages for yet, although they're not tested. They should be working as well. Fedora, as you've seen on the tablet, you can install that pretty easily. And also for OpenSUSE, Arch Linux, we have packages. One thing we didn't mention in our gallery is that we can also run Maliit on the N100 on Fremantle. Michel demoed that recently, and this is documented also on the wiki if you are interested in that. It's not a target platform for us, really. It's not really super important for us, but if anyone's interested, go for it. Except for installing, we also have a roadmap. So if you're interested in contributing or just what we are wanting to do, we now have a roadmap. Maliit 1.0 is the most important part of the roadmap, maybe. That's what we're working towards now. And the goal with that is to have a long-term stable release that we are happy with, especially in terms of APIs, so that we will keep them stable for a long time. And the goal is to have this ready for MeeGo 1.3, which is then October, basically. And for MeeGo 1.3, we have some additional goals, which is to have new package names. This is just because we declared our independence, but also setting up. Like currently, it's been very hard to change plugins on MeeGo, and we need to fix that. And then have integration in the application. So, for instance, the email application will modify the keyboard to say "send" when that is the action that they want to have on the keyboard, for instance. But you can have a lot of nice stuff there. Yeah, and I think that's it for the wiki. And yeah, also one thing, if you're interested in contributing, not just seeing what we're doing and what we want to do, we have this ideas page, which has a lot of ideas. Some are crazy, some are really like things we really want to do, but we don't want to promise doing them, so we haven't put them in the roadmap. But if anyone is interested, this has a lot of good stuff. For instance, input methods, input method plugins can be developed. We have improving the different integrations we have at GNOME 3. We have some bit more crazy ideas, like using supporting Windows. And so if you're interested, going there would be a good idea. There's also, of course, always bugs that needs to be fixed. And contribution to that, very welcome. Then the MeeGo bug tracker is the most important page. Where are we? Yeah, so a bit about this independence and how the project works. Maliit is now, since the last week, an upstream project. This basically means that we develop our software, the software is in our control, in kind of our way. We set our own roadmap. MeeGo and Harmony, which we've previously been a part of, in a way, are downstream projects. So they use our stuff. They, of course, provide a lot of feedback. And they're very important downstreams for us. They're the most important ones at the moment. So we have dedicated members on the team working on both of them. And it's any feedback they give. I mean, our 1.0 schedule, for instance, is synced with MeeGo 1.3, just because that makes sense. It's an important downstream for us. And we have a large team in Helsinki, and smaller teams in Canberra and here in Berlin. So that's us three from Berlin. We are moving more and more communication in the open. This is obvious in a way with open source project, but not always easy in practice. We have now our public mailing list, public RT channel. We do as much as we can there. We still have regular telecom communications with internally in our team. We have a goal for the Maliit.org website to use freedesk.org infrastructure. We have a request for this, and hopefully this will sort itself out, and then we can say that we are truly an independent project and have basically all communication in the open. And this is some of our relationships. So you have Maliit in the center, just because we're awesome. No, because this is what we're talking about. MeeGo and Harmton as downstreams, as users of it. And especially now with the Kitchen Timber Summit, we understand that there's bigger changes going on in the area that we are. So Wayland, this new display server, or display server protocol, is coming fast. And we're cooperating with them because this means changes for us. A lot of the stuff we have now depends on X, and we rely on X for a lot of stuff. Maybe we need to fix this so that we are ready when Wayland, when MeeGo will use Wayland, for instance, another project will use Wayland. And Qt 5 is also something that's coming pretty fast. And we realized with Qt 4 and extending the support in Qt 4 for mobile platforms, mobile-centric input methods, there was a lot of things that weren't really there. So we have a lot of stuff we provide for Qt that actually belongs in Qt. And with Qt 5, we have an opportunity to actually put this in Qt where it belongs. So we are working towards that. Yeah, how to contribute. Maliit.org will give you the wiki that I previously showed you a bit. Check the ideas page, which I also showed. And there's, of course, a lot of ideas there. I will make it so more easy to find the easy ideas, I mean, what's good for new contributors. But you can also, you don't have to pick anything there or pick a bug. You can, if you have interesting stuff that aligns with our goals, please do propose new ideas. Come up with interesting stuff and talk to us. Use our communication channels that are linked on the page. As a practical tip, try to get the Maliit plugin SDK running. It's a good way to check that you have the basic setup done. So you install Maliit, download the SDK, and extract and compile these examples. If you have done that, you know that you basically have all what you need to start developing with Maliit and for Maliit.
Excuse me? The Maliit.org website is already available, or?
It currently forwards to the MeeGo Wiki, which I showed.
Okay.
So eventually it will be on our own web server somewhere.
Okay, sure.
So yeah, do we want to do the plugin stuff? Okay, any questions? That's fine.
Please take some.
Thanks. How far you already implement the IHN support?
The Asian support.
The support for Asian projects.
Yeah. So as shown in the architecture diagram, you have the input method, which is the actual keyboard for Asian, for instance. It uses an interface which we also provide for Asian engines. However, there is no, so on the keyboard side, everything is there, but there is no open source engine at the moment. So there's an interface there that needs to be implemented by an open source plugin. So this needs to be done.
Okay. And the second question is, it seems like a possibility to have an interface like in Star Trek.
Okay.
So how far can is it? Can I make it dependent from the use case? This means from a special function which I use. That I don't use the menu as a program, that I use a keyboard as a possibility to get an interface.
Well, currently we are focused on text input methods.
Okay.
But we're really interested in extending this to, for instance, do actions. Like a menu is a series of actions, essentially. And this is something we would like to look at. We don't have the manpower to do really this in the team, But if you're interested in this, we would be too. So.
So it is also possible to import blocks of text?
Yes, there's no limitation. I mean, typically on a keyboard you input one more character. But for instance, if you have word prediction in your keyboard, then this will, for instance, suggest a word. You can accept that, and then we'll insert the entire block of text.
Okay, thanks.
What about the thumb type keyboard? So normally the Maliit input methods come down from below the screen.
Yes.
What about coming from the sides? So with your keyboards on your thumbs?
Yeah.
Like in Windows 8.
There's a bit of a challenge. I mean, in general, we don't impose any restrictions on if it comes from the top or the side or anything. The area that the input method occupies, I mean, it's a separate window from the application. So we need to tell the application about this area. And currently we have the limitation that this can only be a square area. So if we have things coming from both sides, we have a bit of a challenge. But this is something we have thought about, and we want to fix this. So yes, should definitely be possible. And I definitely want to play with that on the tablet, because it doesn't make sense to do it in the middle.
Yeah, because that's a big bad thing about this on-screen keyboards I don't like. It pops out and your screen is away.
Yeah, you do lose quite a significant bit of space, especially when you have these really wide screens, but not very tall at all.
What's the problem? Actually, it's going to be easier with Wayland. With Wayland, we can define our own policy for our textures where they should appear. Then we can split up the keyboard into as many areas as we want. We can say, well, this is the leftmost area that should always come from the left side. This is the rightmost area, it's come from here. This is some kind of policy that would be annoying. Not impossible, it's actually doable. It would be a bit annoying to have certain eggs and then to synchronize everything. If you really want to have different areas, you have to actually create eggs and for everything then to make it really work. So we've been discussing that when we were thinking about this Wayland interface for input methods. And I think we're just going to do that. So instead of having one rectangle, you can submit a list of rectangles, and then you're even going to go so far to have the semantics in Wayland directly. As I said, left side, right hand side, bottom, top, so you have these areas preset for you. But I don't think that you're going to do that for X.
But it's possible.
Yeah, it's really possible.
Okay.
Thank you. Any other questions?
No? Yeah, we'll have a bit of a demo.
Maybe we'll do it.
Well, it's up to you.
Yeah. You can try some live coding. It will, of course, fail. What I have here is from our examples, basically. This is a QMI code that uses our QMI interface. Maybe I should explain a bit what this means. So when we, let's start here. So this mentions this M input method quick thingy. And this is our root context that we inject into the QML view. So this provides a way for the input method plugins to talk to the framework, but also to the application. And there's one of the things that I don't like in QML, and it's all this hard coding of stuff. So we provided properties that you can easily access screen width and screen height. I've seen there's also support now in QML for that. There were some components that I've seen similar stuff. But this means it really adjusts, this canvas really adjusts to your desktop. It still doesn't work for multi-screen setups, which is annoying. So when we continue here, this rectangle then, in this view, is anchored to the bottom, in the center, and supposed to take up half of the screen size, the full width, as you can read there. And we have some text, a text label, hello world, again centered in this rectangle, which is kind of a huge button if you want. And of course then the mouse area on top of that. And when we look what happens on this on-click handler, we see that we call this root context, because it's set commit a slot on this root context. And then we can just send the button text currently there over to, over the wire to the application. This is just some initialization stuff that you usually do. The component finished loading, you probably want to set up some stuff first. One of the things is the input method area, which tells us there's one of these X niceties. We have to tell the X when you touch on the display which events should go to our keyboard and which events should go to the application. And that's what you do with this input method area. If you don't do that, or if you use a full screen, then you can't interact with the application. Then it might not be possible to close the keyboard anymore because going to the back button or whatever is hidden by your plugin. This would be very annoying. What's more? I should probably try to compile it. Yeah, that's very easy. What I have here is our test application that we usually that comes with our SDK. The SDK is really small and it's currently really only targeting or trying to make it easier for plugin developers to get started. Before we didn't have such a thing, so it already is an improvement. So now I click here. Very small, but readable. Hello world. And I click on that and it shows already that you can insert more than one character if you want. You can insert a whole word, a whole sentence, whatever. This uses this Qt commit and pre-edit infrastructure. So let's hide it again. Maybe we should improve that. So first what I'm going to do is to, I don't want to have this big, this huge button. I want to have another rectangle here. Let's say, let's call it that. Now comes my preferred part, Kimmel. We also want to center it. Let's give it a nice color. Perhaps a border. That's what's a border color, I think. And now we move this text thingy inside.
Yeah, I'm just going to give one small comment. Actually, I see from the top here, actually the element above rectangle you currently see, and that the input method is actually responsible for the entire screen, which means that we basically give the plugin all the control over the UI, and this is what gives the flexibility that we have in a framework. I mean, you can put whatever you want there, basically. So a virtual keyboard doesn't, I mean, that's not very interesting. Everyone does that. So you can put your Star Trek interface there. You have full control over the screen. So the reason why we tell the framework about the size of the area we use is so that applications can take this into account, so that the keyboard or your Star Trek interface never overlaps with where you want to type.
So I modified this button a bit. Now, of course, it doesn't fit this whole hello world anymore. But now it's smaller and black border, green background, and white font. I also made it a bit bigger. This is still not very interesting. You can do it. Now, what I actually want to do, I want to implement a cycle key. So I want, if I press on this button, maybe a cycle through different keys, like on a T9 keyboard. Usually I start on your Symbian device. So for that, I'm going to add two properties. One is the cycle key. So this is what's going to appear on this button. And I'm going to have another property, which is basically the index, dimensional payment index. So instead of using hello world here, I think I have to initialize that. I don't know. I should probably. Yeah, so let's try that. Now I should just show an I, right? It's a bit annoying that I always have to restart the UI server only because the plugin changed. Automatic reloading, also one of these easy things that someone could just start with. Hey, yeah, still not what I wanted, it doesn't cycle, right? So now I go to these, to this mouse area, which this mouse area, I did that when Neon mentioned how we cover the lock screen. I cleverly changed this anchors film to button. So now it doesn't fill the whole area anymore, it only fills the area of the button. It only takes the events from there. For the unclicked handler, actually need to only change. I love this editor. What we need to do is that on every click we increment the counter, right? And then once it overflows we start with zero again. So, I can do that there. And maybe I want to give some feedback that the button is pressed. That's also intuitive. I call it button, right? So I just change this property to black color property. And then, click which comes, how does it go? You first have the press event, this is I press, and then on click you receive that and you actually release the button and the click and the thing gets committed, right? So it's only natural to set it back to what it was before here. I'm starting it again, another restart. And I should. Hey, yeah. That's all.
Yeah. So what Michel used here was the plugin SDK that you can download from a website. And you can use this together with the packages that we provide we've used it with MeeGo. There are some version restrictions, and this is documented under occupation documentation. And then you can get this running pretty easily. And you can then start with the example that Michel started with, and you can do a cycle key if you like, a Star Trek interface if you like, or any other.
Under which license do you put the framework?
Framework is under LGPL, so it allows proprietary plugins.
I also have a question, the name, Maliit. What does it mean?
You have to go to the wiki to find that out.
Okay. That sounds means easy.
From small things, it's a Tagalog, so from the Philippines.
Okay.
Yeah. So imagine probably.
Not a Finnish word, then.
No.
It looks like a Finnish word, but it isn't.
No, it's not.
Yes, it could be. Okay, thank you.
Oh, try one thing with the N9. Try to have Maliit. This error is web prediction.
Okay. I will do so, so give me N9. I could. Are there any other questions?
So, I want to have an application and I want to write a default plugin that's going to be used with that application. I cannot dynamically load my plugin to an already running Maliit in the background.
That's what I said. We don't have the support yet. There's been already someone who would be interested in that. It simply hasn't been on our feature list. I think, especially for developing, actually, it would make more sense to if the plugin directly changes, you just keep reloading it, the plugins. Maybe you have to restart the server in the background, but it shouldn't take that long. I mean, currently it starts on the desktop in what? Less than a second or what? So it's not really a problem to just restart and then the plugins change.
Maybe I don't want to be
rude. The UI server actually runs in as the same user as the session. So it doesn't run as a, it's not started by the init process, but it started by the session. So when you're going to it, when you use the GDM user, when you have the login screen, for instance, and then you would use your normal user when you actually log in. So that's not a real issue.
Okay, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, and I think we will have a short break and then we go to the stat contest.
At the half
of Deutsch. Okay. So we will go on in 10 minutes. Thank you.